the Squid, and I decided to make this video for a variety of purposes, but mainly because I wanted to stop having to show every individual in ceramics how to center and throw a pot. You could simply go look at it in the video and refresh your memory and maybe solve a few of the problems you were having on the wheel instantly without having to mix up the clay and all that sort of thing. And besides, it was fun to do. When you use the kick wheels in the pottery room, each wheel has a different wheel head. The plaster bats that fit on the wheel head are not all interchangeable. So look at the particular wheel that you're using and pick the proper bat. You really can't use interchangeable. So if the bat's dry, take a sponge, wet it a little bit. A totally dry bat will not allow the clay to stick to it. Just a little bit of water is all you need. When you throw the clay down, throw it with a splat, like that. And remember, when you're centering the clay, you need the most speed of all. You need a lot of speed to center, but that's the only time you need the speed. Then you need to get your legs at the same height, and you need for your elbows to be resting on something solid, either your legs or the splash pan, your hips, but so that your elbows don't wiggle around. They need to be secure. You need water on top of the ball of clay. You don't want any drag. And you want this part of the hand not to touch the bat. So as you put your hand down, allow it to be at least a finger's width above the bat. In your two positions you can work from, you can either take your hands like this, put them at a right angle, one on top of the other, and approach the ball of clay from, if this were a clock, from 12 o'clock, which would be at the top of the pot here, or of the potter's wheel. Or you can lock the elbow of the left hand into your body and push with this part of the hand and simply secure the left hand with the right one and push the clay into position. Either way works, as long as you get the ball of clay into the center. That's the push method, and the pull method is like this. And mostly, you simply hold your hands very still for just a couple of seconds. There's a little bit of pulling or a little bit of pushing, but mostly it's just holding the hands very still. And when it's centered, lock a finger, like your little finger, on the splash pan, and hold your thumb out so that it touches the edge of the ball of clay. And if it touches evenly all the way around, you're centered. Get rid of this little collar of mud that's left on the bottom here. That really is of no value to you, so you get that off, get it out of the way. And I like to put the extra clay up on the table rather than down into the splash pan, because you have to dig it out of the splash pan. Always have the shape of the ball of clay like a half of a ball on the bat. You don't want it real flat and you don't want it real tall. You want it sort of like somewhere in the neighborhood of a half a ball. Now we open it up. Take your left hand, put it at a 45 degree to the top of the ball of clay. Take the right hand and put it on top of that left hand with the sponge between the two hands, and let water run down your fingers, and you push just slightly off center on your side of off center until you form this little mound of clay that you just get out of the way. But that allows you to have a center. If you try to start right in the center, you'll generally be off center. So we continue that until it goes down to within about a half inch of the bottom. And then we test it. And to test it, you simply take your knife and you put the handle right in the middle, hold a finger out so it touches the edge, come outside of the pot, and you'll see, in this case, it's almost too low. Also, the fact that this is a, this bath has a sunken center, which makes it a little bit of an illusion. So we can fill that bottom in by simply going back down the wall like this, pushing down, and putting more clay on the bottom. And that's all we need to do. Okay, now we're at the depth we need to be. The next thing we do is we take the left hand. Remember, it's always the left hand that goes inside the pot. You pull the fingers of the left hand straight up, opening up the bottom of the clay form so that it's wide down next to the bat. And then you take your hands and you push the top part of it back together like this, and make a narrow opening at the top. All that sets you up for your first pull on the clay. Get all the extra water out of the pot. To leave that in there simply will weaken the walls of the pot and cause it to collapse if you're not careful. Now set up a groove right down next to the bat like this. And with your fingers of your left hand inside the pot, the thumb hanging out, and you basically put your two thumbs together like this, and you take whatever part of the finger that you want to use. I like to use the knuckle a lot, or the tip of that finger. And at this point also, you don't need a lot of speed. You only need a moderate speed. And you lock this elbow down so it's not falling or flying around free. So it's locked into your body. And you push in right down the back, and you start to lift both hands up. And as you're lifting up, you're releasing pressure on the clay. All the time you're going up, you're releasing pressure, not increasing, but releasing. And when you get to the top, you let the clay run free in your hands about three rounds, and then you ease away from it. You release pressure on your shoulders first, then your elbows, and your wrists, and then your hands away from the clay. Then you go back with thumb and first finger of the left hand, and either the sponge or just the first finger of the right hand, and you level that top. And it's important you always go back to the top and level it after you've made a pull. To make another pull, you simply go down whatever, however many fingers you can get in the pot at this point in the left hand. And you make another groove at the bottom, and then you simply lift that groove with both hands up the wall. And you lift at a speed of the width of your finger per round of the wheel. So the slower your wheel's going, the slower you're moving. And before I let the wheel stop completely, I'll stop and pick it up where I left it, take it onto the top. Everything we're going to make on the wheel, we're going to make from a cylinder. So you always want to start with a cylinder. You should have the cylinder pulled in three pulls and three tries on the wheel. If it takes more than three tries, probably the clay won't stand up to it, and you'll have a collapsed pot anyway. Next thing we need to do is choke this in a little bit. This is called choking. It gets its name from the fact that it looks like you're choking somebody. Got to put a little humor in pottery. And then you have to trim. To trim, every time you choke, the top level of this pot's going to get uneven. So you take your left hand, first finger and thumb, put your a pinpoint, and you trim with a pinpoint. You think you trim with a knife, but you don't trim with a knife, you trim with a pinpoint. You put this thumb and first finger on here, you ride this pinpoint against your thumb, and you angle it 45 degree angle up, and you go down a quarter of an inch from the top of the pot. And you kind of see that. And it causes a little rim. You can cut less than a quarter of an inch if it's fairly smooth, but you might as well just go ahead and go for a quarter of an inch at least, maybe, or a half. I think that's more than a quarter. And then you can get that ring and fall, and throw it away. Go back and smooth that with your fingers and the wet sponge. Keep that level and smooth. Now, the reason we have to smooth the top and level, particularly to smooth it like this, is to, so that we line up clay platelets so they're tied together and not stacked together like cordwood. It acts as a rubber band right around the top. Now, at this point, all we've got is just a straight cylinder, and what I'm going to make out of this, I'm going to try to stretch this just a little bit more because I want just a little bit more height, but I'm not going all the way to the bottom. Okay, now for another choke, and this time we're going to choke with the idea of taking the top in and making it into a bottle form. At this point, with a cylinder, you can either stretch it out into a bulbous form, or you can squeeze it into more of a choked-in vase form or narrow-necked form. And as you do that, top, it's all on level. You go back and trim it again. There's no way you can make that level with just the tips of your fingers. You really have to cut that off. And you can continue to choke that. You can drop lower and choke this. You can make this more of a long-necked bottle. As you do that, you're making the wall thicker, so you have to kind of stretch that out a little bit to keep it from getting too heavy. Now, for the most part, a bottle like that's complete except for the bottom trimming. We would go down here, pick up a little bit of slip that's hanging on the inside, and we'd trim. Now, the trimming is probably one of the most complicated things to do on the wheel. You take the knife and put it in your left hand like this, like you're a left-handed stabber, and you line your fingers up on the blade like this, and you work between 3 and 4 o'clock right here. Simply parallel the pot down, and you trim the excess off of the bottom, and as you go down, you angle out and go in more of a 45-degree angle. Take the blade in the right hand this time, let it slide flat on the surface of the bat and slide under that clay, stop the wheel and take the collar of clay off, and it finishes off the form down next to the bat. And you need that clay just simply to hold the form up until you're finished with it, so you don't want to take that off until the last thing. Now we're ready for the last step at this point, which is simply to take the wire. And take the wire, put the handles in your palms of your hands, and wind the excess wire around it, and use these thumbs as kind of measuring sticks. If you need to wind it again, do that. Put it flat against the bat, and just slide under it with a slight turn of the wheel. Don't spin the wheel around, or you'll lose the pot. Then wet your hands, get rid of the extra water or the clay on your hands, and make them wet. Spread your fingers like this, palms up, rock the wheel like this, pick up the pot and set it aside. And that's it for one pot. Okay, now at this point, We're going to start stretching the clay into a bulb form. Now, when you do that, you don't want to stretch a cylinder out so thin that you have nothing to stretch out into the width of a form. So, we have a little thicker walled cylinder when we start. Now that a rib works really well on the inside, but I'm not sure this form is big enough to get the rib in there. But you want to make sure that you do everything you're going to do to the inside of the form while it's still attached to the wheel like it is now. You don't want to cut this off, set it aside, and come back later and say, well, I want to go in there and work on the inside. There really is not that chance. You can't reattach it to the throwing head. So you do everything that make the inside look exactly the way you want it to while it's attached to the wheel. The outside's a different story. You can turn it upside down on its lip, and you can take a trim tool, and you trim areas off of it. You can alter the outside considerably, but that inside's out of reach. So to make a larger, wider form, you simply stretch the clay out. Now the base in this case is still basically the same base it was with the bottle. It's a narrow base. And for the size of it, for the amount of clay that we're throwing this time, that's about as wide a base as you want. But if you pull the base out to almost the width of the wheel and you've got a lot more clay on here, you simply get a much bigger, rounder form. I can make this more of a ball by simply choking. But you don't want a turn in clay that would be a right angle turn. If I brought this in so that it was like that, then it would probably fall straight in. So you want a kind of angle left into the wall for support. And always give some time to the lip. Don't leave your pot until you've actually taken the time to do whatever you want the lip to do. Maybe you want to turn in or turn out. And you certainly want it to be smooth, probably, if it's a functional pot. And what we're really dealing with here is pots that you could use. And there are all kinds of pots that you don't use, but usually they're only valid if they're made by somebody who understands a functional pot. There are an awful lot of teapots out there that nobody can drink tea out of, but they're nice, pretty great looking pots. Okay, now we're going to trim this one just as we did the last form. Well, and that's the bulb form. We made two different forms today, one a bottle form and one a bulbous form, and they're fairly general. They're forms that you would be required to make, and they all come from a cylinder, so any form you're going to make is going to be relative to these two, with the exception of a plate, and we may make another video sometime about a plate, because it's a whole other ball game. But this is, these two forms should get you off the ground, so to speak, and introduced to the basics of making a form on a wheel.
Seal Films, tape number 2, over.